I'm Sriram, and this is the first Linux conference outside of what we do in automotive, Genevieve for me. I'm with KPIT, and I'm also in participating in Genevieve. I'm an expert group architect in one of the expert groups we have that focuses on C devices. My slide decks are going to be a little different. They're going to be more probing in terms of what potential solutions we could come up with for unique problems that we have in vehicle infotainment. So we're going to go through this, what's there, and I'm probably going to rush through some of the slides. So what do we mean by device management in IVI, and subsequently look at what's there in Linux, talk Linux, and kind of touch upon what potential solutions. And I would really appreciate if we can have a discussion around here so that we get some directions on how to proceed on this. So we all know this. Basically, when we say device management, we are talking about detecting, classifying the device and configuration. And this is pretty much what, coming from IVI, you attach a device, and just to set the disclaimer, when we say device, we basically mean in IVI, we mean a consumer electronic device or a pluggable device, something that a user could bring in the car and then plug in the USB slot, and boom, we need some features, some use cases that we want to realize, all of that. So we attach a device, detaching a device, we want to know what device it is. And since in modern infotainment we have a lot of apps, applications, different applications with different responsibilities, we also want these features and capabilities to be published to the applications. And we are talking completely user space here. And finally, we also need to have some devices to be set up. And this is the part where things become different for us. So there are a whole lot of devices that we deal with. As you can see, it's wired, wireless. I think these parts are the important ones. We have independent devices, which like smartphones or smart devices. Then we also have USBs, the SD cards, which do not really have any processing power by themselves. The CD drives, they are still being used, believe it or not, in several vehicles, they are still being used. So we still have to deal with them. And then there are wireless devices. I can't see the full slide here, so I'm just gonna probably make it. It's okay. I guess I can just do this better. Okay. What we are considering in our scope is only wired USB devices. And believe me, there's a whole lot of them that we have to deal with. What's more interesting is not it's just USB devices, but how we actually deal with these devices, what we actually do with these devices when we are in the vehicle. If it's a mass storage device, it's a very common functionality. We mount them, and we access media, audio, video. And we also have a whole lot of MTP-enabled devices, and we believe we will continue to have them at least for the next few years. We have this whole class of Apple devices where there is a lot of proprietary stuff, fundamentally remote controlling some of the features of the Apple devices. Some of these Apple devices also have special features like iPod out. It's a well-known term where there is some replication of functionality on the IVI side. The Android devices, we have to detect, and sometimes there is some remote control apps. There is mirror link and of course apps. There are a whole lot of technologies that are popular now. Smart device link from Ford, which has been opened up and being hosted by Genevieve, is one such option. So where you have a connectivity to the device and you are able to control the apps. Now, if you notice, the in-vehicle infotainment handling of devices is very different from what we do in a typical environment. The desktop-based environment, let's say. Fundamentally, we want to foster safe driving. We want people to be able to access all the features on the devices that they carry, the nomadic devices that they bring in, without actually impacting the safety of the driver or of any passenger or, let's say, somebody on the road either. So that brings a lot of challenges, and then just few of them. And then there is also some differences that we need to consider from a desktop versus in vehicle. I'm just using desktop here because it's easy to relate to. So if you look at it, there's a whole lot of HID devices that we bring in the desktop. Exotic keyboards, gaming controls, joysticks, stuff like that. Whereas in vehicle, we don't really need any of them. I mean, it's just a display, touch screen, and you just plug the devices and you expect them to play. There are a lot of hardware extensions that's possible. You could kind of plug devices on the USB, add additional peripherals. Doesn't happen in IVI. The third one is really, really unique. Like, you want to connect a device in two modes. For example, you as a driver would expect that I plug in my iPhone, it's charging over USB, while at the same time I'm able to stream audio over A2DP. Something that doesn't happen in a, let's say, regular desktop use. And of course, these apps. I mean, apps actually are very cool. They are something that the vehicle users actually use when they are not in the vehicle, and then they certainly want them to be available when they are in the vehicle. So there's a consortium called Car Connectivity Consortium, which is actually developing a spec called as Mirror Link. And of course, there is also other means of connecting to the devices. Ford's App Link or the Smart Device Link is another one. So if you see, there is lot of additional functionality that we need to bring in beyond generic device management that's available in Linux. So in our expert group within Genevi, there's also a system infrastructure expert group. We have Gunnar from that expert group here. So it's kind of cross-linking both of them. So of course, UDEV is the stock solution that's available that does all of these. So a solution has to be based on UDEV. So we looked at UDEV, and we kind of looked at, okay, what all portions are relevant to us. So we saw, yes, all of them are. In fact, UDEV is a component that that we are using, and this kind of gives a quick overview of what exactly UDEV does. There's a daemon, the kernel events are handled by, the events are handled by the daemon, and then there's an event process, and notifications goes to other applications. So we decided that we want to have these device management to make use of the UDEV infrastructure for sure. But we also found that a lot of things in UDEV are not required, at least as is, especially the features in the user space daemon, whether it's the systemd dot UDEVD or UDEV service or the UDEV daemon itself when you are not doing systemd. And there is also a control layer required on top of what UDEV provides. So we looked at some solutions, and invariably what we found is in the UDEV rules, we are actually launching user space utility processes, and sometimes they are different processes, and different processes have to, I mean, applications have to kind of hook on to or let's say listen to dbus messages from multiple processes. Or if you could combine all of them into one, then it's potentially the same thing as having a separate solution. So basically, this is where we are right now. There is some prototype implementation available, but this is where we are right now. Yes. Yeah. Oh, there is no problem with UDEV as such. The thing is, what UDEV provides by itself is not sufficient. And then there are a few things beyond that, for example, the rules processing. So, I mean, there are a whole lot of rules that we typically have in any distribution. What we notice is most of these rules are probably not required for an IVA environment. I mean, it's actually a limited set of rules that are required. Not all the rules are required. So the point I'm trying to make here is rules processing is one, but beyond that, within IVI, the challenges are completely different. Like if I connect an Apple phone, I want to set up the Apple phone in a certain way. There is a configuration that I have to establish. It's basically a communication protocol that I have to do with these devices and then set them up. The same thing applies to MTP or even with some of these Android phones or mirror link phones. So there is nothing in UDEV that stops me from doing that. So I could use UDEV and I could write a rule, launch a program, and that does that. But we might end up having a whole lot of small utilities and not really having a central control. That's what I see as an issue here.
Sorry. So what you're saying is that the UDEV rules deployed currently on the desktop do not match for the IVI environment. And what you want to do is have more, instead of different application or specialized application doing one thing, you want just to have a more central application which handles all the devices. Is that what?
Right, and it's actually a requirement. So if you bear with me, what potentially could happen in an IVI is, let's say you have your iPhone, you have got two USB ports on the IVI faceplate. So you could plug in two devices at the same time. You could plug in a USB mass storage device and possibly an iPhone. And the behavior may not be something that the vehicle manufacturer wants to have as a default behavior, like the SD card, the USB getting mounted plus the iPhone connected at the same time, both of them playing media at the same time. Now, you know, mounting is pretty common, it's inbuilt, but if you look at this Apple device, then I need to do something exotic about it. So if I have an application which needs to know about both of these, about the mounting of the SD card or the USB as well as the iPhone, then I need to now kind of listen or talk to two separate user land programs, one for Apple devices and one for, let's say, U-Disks, if I go with a U-Disks-based solution. I'm sorry. And that's where I see a central control required so that I can inhibit few things, like, oh, you connected an iPhone, your iPhone could be charging, but hey, wait, you can't use your iPhone as a media source because you already are playing from USB. It's that kind of control that's required. So I could write rules in UDEV, and there would be two different programs, or if I want this central control, I might actually write two rules, but both of them launching the same user space program so that the control is built into that. That's one part of it. The second part is, the way UDEV does is it processes all the rules. It keeps on. So there are a whole lot of rules that may not be necessary the way we set up things in IVI. That's personally what I have observed based on my experiments with a system, with an IVI system based on an ARM processor. I'm sorry. Does that help you or? Okay, thanks.
Why do you list firmware loading there as something that UDEV does? Because nowadays UDEV doesn't load firmware anymore.
Thanks for correcting me. I may not be fully correct in that. If it doesn't do that, then actually it's not required. And when I looked up the code, I did see there were some pieces of it, so I just retained it. So thanks for correcting me. It's not required anyway. Okay. I don't know where I kept it. Skip this. So what we are doing is we are creating a component, and let me just go back. I think I missed one slide. Yeah, this is the slide I wanted to talk about, and I would really like all of you to provide your thoughts. So these are the potential options we are actually looking at. And thank you very much. And I must say that when we were experimenting with all of these, there were a lot of developments happening upstream as well with systemd. And this is like kind of not finalized yet, but just want to bring out where we are. So we could use a combination of static trees. Anyway, bulk of the dev nodes are created. And one alternative that we also contemplated and still are contemplating is not to use UDEV in user space. I mean, use libUDEV, but kind of replace the UDEV daemon. And why this is coming from is actually because the customizations that we want to put inside UDEV, it's not possible as it is today, at least. I mean, it seems like a closed door for me. That's my understanding. You can correct me if I'm wrong. So these are the options that we have, and coexist with a lightweight version of UDEV. So in the user space, so I'm not saying that we don't use UDEV, but only in the user space, I'm talking about the UDEV daemon here. So do we need two services running at the same time, which are kind of overlapping in terms of behavior, or we could just have one? We have not finalized the answer yet. We are just thinking about whether this could be done. Yes.
So, I mean, this is just how you talking to the kernel. I mean, you could easily just have one rule for UDEV and just always calling the same application, then you would have the same, right?
That's right. So that option is already there. I mean, if you see, there is, in fact, that's the option we are currently using, Daniel, is to have very few rules. It's not one rule. Actually, I've done a pilot where I was just trying to get it working, where there are only 4 or 5 rules, and we are good enough with that. So yes, that's always possible. And maybe for some time, this is what we would look at. But what concerns me more is the considerations that I have put down, like a systemd. The developments that's been happening in systemd and around UDEV, these are all very interesting to us, and systemd is an important component that that we use in Genevi, so we have to coexist with that. So I'm kind of opening here and asking, like, what could be done? I mean, we have some unique problems, like the way we set up these devices when we are in the vehicle, and we also want some kind of inhibition between between these devices when one is working, the other is not. So, if you could suggest, like, what's the best way to work with it, that would absolutely be wonderful. This is what we have created so far. You're saying something, Daniel? Okay. So this is what we have created within Genevi so far. We created this component, and which kind of replaces UDISCs and uses a minimalistic version of UDEV daemon in user space. And it allows you to actually code through plugins. I mean, you can write your own plugins, because like it or not, in IVI we still deal with a lot of proprietary stuff. In automotive we still deal with proprietary stuff, and we need to make some provisions for the proprietary stuff to stay. So that's why we have this mechanism where you could actually program it, so you don't have to write a rule. If you write it in the rule, then again you need to kind of combine it back. So you could write a proprietary user space program, but then to tie it back with the other components could be a challenge. So we went with this approach, and we have something working. I mean, we do have a prototype that's pretty much working. As I said, with UDEV in user space, with a minimal rule set. And we're also experimenting on having without this UDEV daemon in user space. I'm not taking anything from UDEV or that project there, but it's just a thought that if this service is just going to be running one or two or three rules, then I might as well actually pull it inside this component here. This is pretty much our internal roadmap, let's say. We are kind of backed up on this, but we do have the code. It's just a matter of pushing it. We do have the code, and it's going to be available for all of us to play with by this time frame. Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. So can you go back to that slide with the architecture? Yeah, that one. So what's happening in the core? And I mean, what I understand is now you have all the events coming from the kernel, you're just passing it now to one place, and you do something with it. What does it? So my question is, so you have now this central daemon running, and it has plugins and so on, okay. But what does it do with that information?
Yeah, I could explain a little bit here. So if you see, there are like three broad buckets here. So there is this detectors. So as you would guess, the UDEV stuff, the U events are being consumed here, and the U events are actually being passed to this guy. So the core is fundamentally kind of stitching these guys together. So the this plugin can kind of register. So there are some rules inside this. So you can put some filters on this, pretty much like I can say, okay, give me all USB devices. So I can write a plugin here, and I can say, give me all USB devices. Anything that is from the USB subsystem, I want to see them. So you could catch that, and then the classifiers are actually classifying them. So this core is fundamentally tying out all of these layers. Now, the reason why we did it this way here is there are some devices, like, for example, let's take a CD device, a CD player. Now, if you have a CD, in what typically happens is there are USB-based CD, decks, or you could also integrate them over something like an I2C and route the audio or I2S and stuff like that. So that's not standard USB for you. So you need to have a proprietary detection mechanism whenever the CD is inserted, because you're going to get an I2C message, and you process the I2C, and you know that, okay, a CD has been, an optical disc has been plugged in. So that kind of handling, that detection, could be completely different from one IVI system to another IVI system, because those decks are different. And so we might have a different detector, but then, hey, at the end of the day, the optical disc contains media. So what I really want to tell everybody, the applications, is I found a disc or I found a media with songs in it. Can we play this? So this plugin here, you could actually write a content analyzer plugin. So independent of what it is, it gets mounted, and then the content analyzer actually can write, higher level policy-based content analyzers that can actually push some messages. Now let's look at what happens if I insert an iPhone here. Now if I insert an iPhone or USB, it obviously gets detected here, classified that, oh, this is an Apple device, and I need to do something very special that can be done by this handler. And once the handler has done stuff, then maybe we can pass consistent events that, hey, I found a media device, or I found a device which is media, but it is also supporting apps. It is also supporting remote control of apps and stuff like that. So everything that we deal with in our expert group, smart devices, apps on the smart devices, all of that is falling under our expert group. And that's why we wanted to have something like this, which kind of exposes a consistent interface to all the applications. So you plug in a device, for example, if you plug in an iPhone, you would know, okay, this device can be used as a media, or it could be also used as an app container. That's what we use, the phrase that we use is app container. So you can control some of the apps on the iPhone from your application. And any application that you write could take advantage of these messages. So there is some higher level processing that can be done. Now, that's fundamentally the core. You know, the core is actually orchestrating the services between these components. So detectors are very system specific. Classifiers have some logic, and then analyzers are even higher level components. Yeah, and okay, sure. Any questions? Okay, thank you very much.